Welcome back to our intermediate financial accounting class. Over the last few segments, we've been talking about inventory, the different methods we can use to track it, why it's so important, the differences between periodic and perpetual, what errors can do to our net income. And then we went through and did an example, a fun example, that let us use some cool tables to calculate LIFO, FIFO, and weighted average for both periodic and perpetual. In this next segment, we're going to introduce a new method for doing inventory. Not new in the sense that it's just been created, but new in the sense that you probably haven't seen it before. It's one that we don't introduce until intermediate accounting. But it's one that's become very popular because once it gets the hang of it, it can move very, very quickly, especially compared to a perpetual LIFO system, which, as we just did, can become, well, maybe not tedious because it's all fun, but certainly time-consuming. So let's take a look at the dollar value LIFO method, what it does, and how it works. Basically, dollar value LIFO allows companies to combine all of their inventory into one big calculation. Instead of trying to go through and keep track of every single item, we're basically going to do one quick equation at the very end and add that in or subtract that from what we had last period. There's really just two steps to this process. The first is coming up with what we call a price index, and that's the relationship between the current year prices and what we were paying for this inventory when we decided to start dollar value LIFO. The next step is to use that price index to actually create our LIFO layers. And once I've done that, then it's a quick sum of all these layers to get this year's ending inventory value. Let's start by talking about this price index then, this first part of the dollar value LIFO system. There's really four simple steps to making this price index calculation. First, we have to figure out the cost per product in the base year. The base year, again, is the year that we decided to do dollar value LIFO. We're going to relate everything back to that base year so that we can put it all in common ground. If we don't do that, then we're trying to compare this year's prices to last year's prices, to 2 years ago prices, to 20 years ago prices, and it gets really convoluted. If we can relate it all back to 1 year's prices, then it becomes really straightforward to see how inventory has changed from this year to last year to the previous year to 20 years, etc. So we're going to first go back and look at the cost per product back in that base year. Then we're going to figure out the cost per product this year, the year that we're trying to get a price index for. Third, we're going to multiply the number of units in ending inventory by the current year price and by the base year price per unit. Finally, we'll divide the current year total by the base year total, and the result will give us our price index. Let's take a look at an example that I think will make this much more clear. So this is BBEV. They've decided to switch to dollar value LIFO, and here's the information. In year one, they had 10,000 units on hand, and they were paying $15 a unit for that inventory. In year two, they now had 12,000 units on hand, and in year two, they were paying $17 a unit for that inventory. In year three, now they've dropped to 11,000 units, and the cost is now $22 a unit for their inventory. So prices just keep getting bigger and bigger, which is pretty normal for an inflationary system. So let's do our price index calculation, and we don't worry about it as much in year one. If I wanted to compare year one prices to the base year one prices, I'm going to get 1 because the base year prices and year one prices are the same because year one is the base year. So I don't worry about a price index for the current year. I'm just going to know it's 100. That's how we talk about a price index, or 1. So really we want to work with year two. And again, the first thing we're going to do, step one, is to figure out the cost per unit at the base year. So my base year cost was given to us. We were spending $15 per unit. Step two is to get the cost per unit in the current year, or in year two. And in year two, we're now paying $17 a unit. Step three, I'm going to multiply that by the number of units on hand at the end of year two. So 12,000 units. This number. Not this one. This one, 12,000. So let's see, $15 times 12,000 is 180,000. And 17 times 12,000 is 204,000. So my price index will be the 204 divided by the 180, and that's step four, and I get 113%, or 1.13. The way we say a price index by convention is 113. That's how we say it. But we need to, and you need to know, price index, if I see 113, I know it's 113%, or 1.13. Now let's take a look at year three. And we're going to go through the exact same process. So base year, current year. Base year, again, the price per unit was $15. In the current year, in year three, the price is $22. Now let me just take a step back as we look at the problem again. Notice, I'm not comparing this year to last year. That's not what I'm doing. I'm comparing this year to the base year. So I don't care about the year two numbers when I'm in year three. I'm taking everything back to year one. That's the year that matters to me. That's my base year. So in year three, I have 11,000 units on hand. So let's see, 11,000 times $15 is $165. And 11,000 times 22 is 242. So my price index will be 242 and 165, or 147. 147%, 1.47. Now when I teach this in class, I always have somebody who says, you know, you could just divide the 22 by the 15 and you get that same 147. And the answer is, you're right. As long as you only have one product, it works just fine. When you have multiple products, you can't use that shortcut anymore. So if it's just a one product system, go for it, use the shortcut. But let me show you how it's different when you use multiple products. Let's just assume that we work in a company that sells two units, and let's do something clever. We'll call them A and B. And let's say that in year one, we had 10,000 units of A at $10 each, and 20,000 units of B at $20 each. And since it's year one, my base year, my price index is 100, or 100%, or 1.00. In year two, I now have 15,000 units of A, and they're costing me $12 each. And I have 10,000 units of B, and they cost me $25 each. Well, now they're growing differently, and this is what makes it so you can't just do a price relationship, $10 to $12 or $25 to $20, because notice this one's changed by $2. This one's changed by $5, and that's going to mess up my price index calculation. If they'd both grown by $2, I could still do that shortcut that we were talking about. So let's take a look then at what the process would be to do the price index for year two. So base and current, A, B, price in the base year was 10 and 20. Price in the current is 12 and 25, and I'm going to multiply that by the numbers in year two. So 15,000, 10,000, 15,000, 10,000. So let's see, 10 times 15,000 is 150,000, 20 times 10,000 is 200,000. So if I had purchased all of these units back in year one, I'd have spent $350,000 buying them. If I had purchased all of these units in the current year, I would have spent $180,000 buying item A and $250,000 buying item B, for a total of $430,000. And now I can get my price index, 430 divided by 350 gives me a price index of 123. And I can't get that by comparing the 12 to the 10 or the 25 to the 5. So it becomes more of a weighted average. And that's my calculation for a price index. When we come back, we'll start talking about how to do the rest of the dollar value LIFO system. I'll see you then.